Thanks, Rita. Hello, welcome to Midlands Today with me, Nick Owen. The headlines tonight. Walsall's first knife amnesty bin in memory of a young man who was killed nearly 6 years ago.
It's shattering. You know, our lives have been literally been destroyed by that act. But we have to bring some good out of it.
The West Midlands Police Force area has the highest rate of knife crime in England and Wales. Also this evening, a special service in Coventry, amongst many other events across the region, to mark a year since Russia invaded Ukraine. Taking a Stand, a new film about a Sikh woman deciding to wear a turban against her father's wishes.
I thought, how visually striking and stunning is it to see a woman in a turban in a Hollywood poster?
And at times this week, it's felt like spring across the Midlands, but there is something colder in the forecast. I've got the weekend weather later in the programme.
Good evening. Our streets are safer with knives in amnesty bins rather than in pockets. The words of Mark Brindley, whose son James was stabbed to death in an unprovoked attack in June 2017. Today, in his memory, the James Brindley Foundation launched its first knife amnesty bin in Walsall. There'll be an initial 7 bins across the borough as part of a campaign to encourage people to hand in bladed weapons. According to the Office for National Statistics, knife crime is growing faster in the West Midlands than any other area of the UK. In the year to September 2022, the West Midlands recorded a higher proportion of offences, 170 per 100,000 people, than any other region. In that period, there were more than 5,000 incidents involving a knife or sharp object, which equates to 14 a day. Between January and September last year, 316 people were given immediate custodial sentences for offences involving a knife or sharp weapon. That's a third of those charged. A warning, you might find some of the details in James Beauville's report upsetting.
One, three.
The results of years of fundraising in their son's name, the first of 7 knife amnesty bins across Walsall Borough, in memory of James Brindley.
He turned into a beautiful human being. We're determined he should never be a faceless statistic of knife crime. We've got to make it easy for people to dispose legally and safely bladed weapons.
The bin is metres from the spot where James died on Aldridge High Street in June 2017, stabbed in the heart by a 17-year-old in a completely unprovoked attack. 6 years on, and the West Midlands has the highest proportion of knife crime incidents anywhere in the country, a third more than London. I asked the region's mayor why.
It's hard to answer because it shouldn't be like that, should it? I think the issue is, though, that too many young people, in a sense, feel the need to protect themselves. So what the foundation are saying is actually let's A, provide a way of getting rid of the knives so people can reflect again and then dispose them safely, but then more importantly, let's actually train, let's work with people to think about a different approach to this.
West Midlands Police says serious youth violence is one of its force priorities and it's committed to strong enforcement as well as community action to understand the factors that drive knife crime. Paramedic David Miller sees the horror of knife crime firsthand and tells school children about the risks on behalf of the James Brindley Foundation.
I attended in Erdington to a young man who was stabbed through the chest. We actually had to open up the young person's chest in the street. It was traumatic for the people around, it was traumatic for his family. And the worst thing, you know, is that these things stick in your head.
With extra funding, 12 bins in total will be placed around Walsall. A QR code will help young people leave anonymous information about what motivates them to carry a knife. Mark and Beverly Brindley light a candle every Friday for James, near the spot where he died. Their life now is dedicated to preventing more families from suffering the pain they endure every day.
Agony is the word I would use, but you have to carry on. So many people have supported us. People are wonderful. So that's what obviously keeps us going.
Mark and Beverly Brindley talking there to our reporter James Beauville. A minute's silence has been held across the region today to remember all those who've lost their lives in the war in Ukraine. As you've been hearing, it's a year ago today that Russia invaded the Eastern European country. It's estimated that as many as 60,000 lives have been lost on both sides of the conflict. Vigils are also taking place right now, with one at Coventry Cathedral. We can join our reporter Kevin Reid, who's actually there. Kevin.
Nick, yes, well, this is a symbol of the futility of war, the ruins of Coventry Cathedral. And as you can see tonight, they're lit up in the colours of Ukraine. Hundreds of people have come along. This all started at 6 o'clock. There was a procession from the centre of the city through some of the streets, and literally hundreds of people have just filed in the last few minutes. And also earlier today, there was a special service at a Catholic Ukrainian church, also here in Coventry.
We're going to mark the memory of those who have given their lives for Ukraine over the last year.
Many turned up for this so poignant day to remember all those who've lost their lives in this brutal and ongoing war between Russia and Ukraine. The service was held in both English and Ukrainian languages by a priest whose father made Coventry his home after leaving Ukraine as a refugee during the Second World War.
Is it going to be a repeat of what happened in the Second World War? Obviously, I know about this history from my father and the atrocities that happened then. And today, it was really just trying to hold it together, because it's very meaningful. It's very meaningful and very personal. And it's personal to each and every one of us here.
There were hymns, prayers,
by your divine power, do not forsake us,
and Holy Communion. Then everybody filtered outside for a minute's silence. At the same time, across the West Midlands, other silences were being held, like here in Wolverhampton. Back in Coventry, the Ukrainian flag was raised as the silence ended, followed by a rendition of their national anthem.
We're very proud that the Ukrainian army has fought strongly, and we're very grateful to the Western and the British government for providing support. But at the end of the day, people are still losing their lives, and Ukraine needs more support. And so, you know, we hope that the Western nations will continue supporting Ukraine, and we hope this horrible, horrible episode in world history comes to an end soon.
It's been an emotional day for many Ukrainians. Hundreds have made Coventry their temporary home, and with no end in sight to the war, the distressing uncertainty continues. Well, there are prayers being said in both English and Ukrainian here this evening in Coventry Cathedral, where you can see the vigil going on behind me. I'm joined now by Canon Mary Gregory, Canon of Coventry Cathedral. Just tell us what is actually happening in the vigil.
At the moment, there's a Ukrainian requiem where the souls of the dead are commended to God's safe keeping. So this is very much a moment of lament, remembering all those who've lost their lives in the past year. And then the service is going to move to hearing the story of a Ukrainian refugee who has found a home in Coventry at the moment. And then there will be a Bible reading. The Bishop of Coventry will speak. The mayor will bring his greetings, and then the service will end with the great hymn and a prayer that God would bless Ukraine.
It's a very poignant day here today, isn't it?
It's a really poignant day, and it's so moving to see so many people gathered here in the ruins, many more than we'd hoped for, actually. And it's lovely to see the city coming out to support the Ukrainian community.
And of course, in Coventry, we have the City of Peace and Reconciliation. Mm. There is actually a centre here for that. Mm. I mean, do you see an end to this conflict? What are the views on it here?
We pray for the conflict every day. We pray for the people of Ukraine. We pray for the people of Russia as well, because this war is not of many Russian people's choosing. And at the moment, it's hard to see an end to the war soon. But this place, these ruins, stands as a symbol of hope that that is possible. I mean, when these ruins were bombed in November 1940, there was no prospect of the end of that war. But still, the leader of the cathedral in that day said, "We believe that we can rebuild. We believe that we can make a more Christ-childlike world." And I think our job in Coventry is to keep the story of reconciliation alive, to keep that hope alive.
Mary, thank you very much. Well, this vigil will go on for the next 30 minutes or so, ending just after 7 o'clock.
Kevin, thank you. The MP for Stratford-on-Avon, Nadeem Zahawi, says he takes full responsibility for the mistakes in his tax affairs, which prompted his sacking as the Conservative Party chairman. Mr. Zahawi lost his job after it was revealed that he hadn't told officials that he was being investigated by HMRC. In his first television interview, he said he accepted the findings of an investigation by the Prime Minister's ethics adviser.
The important thing, I think, is to make sure that, I remind people that what actually happened was the assessment from HMRC was that it was a careless, not a deliberate issue. It was something that I dealt with immediately, and I accepted without argument the settlement that they put forward, and I moved forward from there.
And you can hear more from Nadeem Zahawi in Politics Midlands with Elizabeth Klinker on Sunday at 10 o'clock on BBC One. A Birmingham man's been given a life sentence for murdering a teenager as he was getting out of his car in Small Heath. 20-year-old Abdirahman Yusuf ambushed and stabbed 18-year-old Yahir Sharif on Coventry Road in December 2021. Yusuf will serve a minimum of 22 years in prison. A lorry driver who admitted causing the deaths of three people in a crash on the A303 near Andover has been jailed for 12 years. Michael Kopeniaus crashed into three vehicles which had stopped at the side of the road while using his phone. 28-year-old Alex Britton from Portsmouth and 58-year-old Tina Ince and Tom Watson, who was 30, both from Southampton, were pronounced dead at the scene on the 25th of August 2021. The e-scooter trial in Birmingham will be paused next Wednesday. It's because the current contract with Voi has ended and Transport for West Midlands say they haven't decided who'll get the next one. They say they know it's inconvenient for people who rent the scooters but hope the scheme will restart as soon as possible. The head of a Midlands charity has just returned from a bike ride across Bangladesh to raise money to build an eco-school in an area of the country prone to flooding. The Freedom 50 bike ride took the cyclist from the capital Dhaka to Sylhet, a distance of nearly 250 miles. Aftab Rahman has joined us here in the studio. Good to see you.
Hi.
First of all, how are you after all that cycling?
Yeah, the cycling wasn't a problem. Bangladesh is largely flat. There's a bit of jet lag, but yeah, it was good fun.
So tell us about this eco school. What is it exactly?
So the eco school, the concept we have in mind is that it would have solar panels to start with, rain capture, and also we're looking for a commission that will go out. We want young enterprising architects to come up with ideas as to how we can galvanize and keep it warm in the winter months and cooler in the summer months. So we don't exactly know what it's going to be like.
It sounds a great plan. I mean, why are you so driven to do this?
Well, 22 years ago, I was in Jamalpur with my friend, and his mum, who's a Birmingham resident, gave up her family land along with her brother. They both gave up their family land, and for the last 20 years, they've been dedicating their whole life in bringing building a hospital, which is four stories, and the school itself hasn't had the same attention as the hospital. The school is a tin shack, as you'll see. And I've been driven by actually trying to improve the lives of young people and giving them...
Yeah, I mean, it is all about future generations. I mean, what sort of response did you get as you were cycling around, along?
It was almost like a hero's welcome. I mean, we were welcomed by the British ambassador in Bangladesh at his residence. And we had a reception. We had most of the Bangladeshi TV crew there, and it was aired whilst we were there. And also social media and so on. So people knew who we were. So we, as we'd pop into cities, people would come and join us on their bikes and welcome us. And, you know, it was. And for us, most of the participants were Bangladeshi. We had one German, a Belgian, and a Pakistani person. So for us, it was homecoming, and it was something that we had worked with for over a three-year period. So we cycled across UK in 2021, and then we did a European bike tour last year, and this
now
was...
This. Now and this. And just briefly, how much are you aiming for and how far have you got financially?
We raised £100,000. That was the target for the school. That's phase one. Now we're looking at building a playground for the children with swimming pool and a bike track. And then we want to... Phase three is to build an enterprise hub for the mums. When they drop the kids off, they can stay on. So it's a three-year plan.
We're going to have to leave it there, but thanks for coming to see us. Lovely to meet you. After Brahman. Thank you. Now, here's a question for you. What happens when a British Sikh woman decides to wear a turban against her father's wishes? Well, that's the theme explored in a new short film currently touring festivals, schools and gurdwaras. It features the star of Goodness Gracious Me and EastEnders, Nina Wadia, and it's been made by a young filmmaker whose family originally moved from South Asia to the Midlands. Its aim is to bring more stories told by Asian women to a mainstream audience. Lindsay Doyle reports.
Oh, you decided to go with the light blue one? Lovely choice. It'll bring out the colour of your...
eyes?
Yeah, I don't know where I was going with that.
It's a film about identity and a desire to highlight the stories of Sikh women who choose to wear a turban.
There's no representation in Hollywood for brown women that look like me. The last film was Bend It Like Beckham, and it was 20 years ago. And I really wanted to see that representation. And I thought, instead of waiting another 20 years, let me do this myself. And I thought, how visually striking and stunning is it to see a woman in a turban in a Hollywood poster?
Core is the story of Avani, who decides to wear a turban for the first time against the wishes of her father, who was reminded of the trauma he endured as a turban-wearing Sikh Punjabi immigrant in Britain.
It's not about respecting you, which you know I do. It's about you facing the facts of what I have decided.
It's not a choice I thought you'd make.
How could you not think that?
Because this isn't a game, it's real life.
We still see racism today, but the story we explore with the father character is that he experienced racism coming from India and experienced it in a kind of different level. So that's what we wanted to go to get that across in a kind of sensitive manner.
Core is being shown at film festivals and gurdwaras with plans to tour schools. For one member of the audience in Handsworth in Birmingham, it has particular resonance.
It was quite a difficult decision I made 10 years ago to start wearing my dastar because I don't have anyone in my family that wears one.
So what did you decide to?
There was like, for me, it was like I had a connection. I came to a gurdwara one day and just something, a light or something sort of shone, and it was a path that I knew I had to take.
Wearing a turban is a deeply important part of Sikh culture, which the film portrays sensitively.
You've seen men wear turbans in the back of blockbuster films. You see them as extras, obviously in our soaps. But where is the female representation? And that's exactly why we wanted to make this film for all the women out there.
You know what? I could really identify with a lot going on in it. Even though I'm not from the same community, I'm glad I came along today.
Yeah, I find it very empowering, and it's nice to recognise Sikh women, and especially the star as well, women to come forward.
The filmmakers are currently working on a feature-length version of Core, hoping to bring more Sikh stories to the big screen. Lindsay Doyle, BBC Midlands Today, Handsworth.
And it's time for sport now. Nick is here. What a big night this is tonight for Wolves at Fulham.
Yeah, it was all starting to look so much more promising for them when they had those two wins at the start of the month back-to-back. But last weekend's home defeat by relegation rivals...
All the players are involved in the responsibility to score and to in the clean sheets, or try to stay in the clean sheet. This is the work about the... This is not tennis, it's football. But of course, we would like, it's a good thing for the striker or for a forward to score for this confidence. But I think that working hard, the goal is going to arrive, sure.
Let's turn to athletics now. A lot of talk about possibilities and world records tumbling this weekend.
Some of the biggest stars in the sport are here for the World Indoor Tour Final. Now, it really is a high-quality field, and they're hoping the brand-new track will lead to some incredibly fast times.
8 Olympic medals, 2 world champions and a world record holder. There was an incredible array of athletics talent checking in at Birmingham's indoor arena this morning. They all line up for the final of the World Indoor Tour tomorrow, with Laura Muir hoping the new track will help her break the world record over 1,000 metres.
It does make quite a big difference in terms of how steep it is when you go around the bends. So I'm quite lucky, I'm quite short, so it's quite good for my stride length anyway. But yeah, the fact it's a little bit shallower, I think will help make it a bit faster too. I've got the second fastest time all time, which is the British and the European record. So hoping to go on better and maybe get the world record on Saturday. So yeah, it's gonna be close, it's gonna be hard. You know, it's one of the more older world records in the book, so it's a tough one, but gonna give it a good shot.
The American Grant Holloway will certainly be tough to beat. He's never lost over 60-metre hurdles, is the world record holder, and won here last year in the Grand Prix.
Great atmosphere, great arena. It's going to be great. I can't wait to hear the crowd roar. I can't wait to see what happens once I put on those black spikes.
Other highlights tomorrow include Jamaica's 200-metre world champion Sharika Jackson, dropping down in distance to take on Britain's top 60-metre sprinters.
I think I have so much more in store for the sprint. It's just been 2 years since I switched to short sprinting, so I just want to see how fast I can go.
While Katie Hodgkinson, who became European 800-metre champion last year, takes on Birmingham's British indoor champion Isabel Boffey over 4 laps. The meeting is close to a sellout, and the athletes are hoping the combination of a raucous atmosphere and a quick track will see the records tumble.
And if you want to see how they get on and any records go, well, you can watch it all. It's on the BBC tomorrow through the iPlayer and the BBC Sport website. Back to you, Nick.
Nick, thank you. Now, this is a bit different. A board game wizard from Birmingham is helping to inspire a new generation of people to gather around a table and get lost in a different world. Will Brasher was inspired to take up the role after suffering a personal tragedy. Audrey Diaz reports.
Wonderful little tile-laying game, right up your alley.
They call Will Brasher the wizard, and when it comes to board games, he knows just how to make others fall under their spell.
He lights up the room, honestly. It's incredible whenever Will comes around. His enthusiasm for everything related to it just bursts. It's bursting at the seams, basically. You think his head might explode sometimes.
It still blows me away just how much he knows about obscure games on the shelves here. Will's got such an encyclopedic knowledge of board games. It's a sight to behold when he's in full flow.
3 years ago, he started to turn his hobby into his profession after answering an advert for a part-time board game demonstrator at a new cafe in Digbeth, and it's grown rapidly from there.
My main part of my job is recommending games, and when there's time teaching people games and just talking about games and showing my enthusiasm, and they refer to me as the wizard, and it's really surreal.
It was a decision that grew out of personal tragedy. In 2019, Will's partner Michaela was suddenly taken ill and died within days. She loved films and had carried her passion into working at a video rental store. Her loss convinced Will to follow his own dream, and he's sure she'd approve.
She would give me that look and punch me in the arm. And as far as I'm aware, a punch in the arm was, "You're doing well, I love you, but really?"
There's a growing demand for his skills. This is one of 3 cafes the company runs in the country.
There's more than 500 games here, everything from Monopoly to Dungeons and Dragons, and it's certainly captured the imagination of those looking for a challenging night out.
I just moved to the UK back in 2021. And so this has been a great place for me to meet new people when I didn't know anyone.
We started coming to the cafe when we were, let's say, less into the hobby, and he definitely has helped us get more into the hobby and recommended various games.
I've been featured in a game. So when they realised I was a wizard, they literally made a little strange picture of me as a little techno wizard.
Will has more than 600 board games at home, but there's always room for one more. And Will is currently working on designing a game in Michaela's memory. Audrey Diaz, BBC Midlands Today, Birmingham.
Time now to meet our own wizard, the wizard of the weekend weather. How's it all looking, Sarah?
Tell you what, it's all fun and games as well, especially at this time of year when you're sort of betwixt and between the end of climatological winter and the start of climatological summer. And certainly today has been like that because we had some beautiful blue skies at times, but we also had an awful lot of clouds. So it has been a very mixed sort of day. And of course, this week at times it's felt like spring. But as I say, in climate terms, we are coming towards the end of winter now. We've got four more days in climate terms and then we'll start spring. And you can see those sort of shoots of hope here starting to come through. We're not quite there yet. And actually, I think through the weekend, you're really going to start to feel like, oh, have we gone back to winter? Because it is going to be colder through this weekend and for the start of next week too. Particularly, we've got a sharp frost tonight, a colder feel tomorrow, in part because we've got a really driving northerly wind. And that colder feel will stay with us into next week. But high pressure off there, weather friend, is sat towards the north of the UK. That, of course, is drawing in that colder air, that northerly wind as well. And through the night tonight, we've got a clearing of the skies. That wind started to pick up, and that means that the temperatures will fall away. -1, -2, maybe -3 Celsius rurally. So a sharp frost and a chilly start tomorrow, but through the day, dry with some sunshine at first. I think out towards parts of Staffordshire into Warwickshire, we could see a few showers. Generally, though, a lot of dry and bright weather, but look at the temperatures. Today, we saw 10, 11, nearly 12 Celsius. Through this week, we've been low teens. 7 degrees with that northerly wind tomorrow is going to feel different. And then into Sunday, again, we'll see a frost around. We've got that colder air with us. The day itself, very similar, really. A lot of dry weather. We do have some cloud. We do have the odd little bit of shower here and there. And it's that kind of day where you're like, is it raining? Is it not raining? That sort of setup. And then into next week, we've still got the high pressure, but it slowly slips around. And so actually our temperatures might just rise a little bit as we start, in climate terms anyway, spring.
Thanks, Sarah. Finally, congratulations to Albert and his owner Jemima Banks from Warwickshire. They're through to the final five candidates to be named as the UK's most heroic dog at Crufts next month. 24-year-old Jemima has a rare condition which means her joints dislocate easily and she lives in chronic pain. But Albert, the assistance dog, means she can now travel to work and fulfil her ambition to become a solicitor. The UK's most heroic dog will be crowned on the final day of Crufts in Birmingham on March the 12th. And that was the Midlands Today. We'll be back at 10:30, late update, including action from Fulham Wolves. Have a good evening. Great weekend. Bye for now.